This is the free version of the August 2016 Patreon Party People podcast. If you would like to listen to the newest podcast as it comes out, just visit patreon.com/blazehedgehog. And welcome to the Patreon Party People podcast for August 2016. It is August the 4th, and I, of course, am Ryan, or Blaze Hedgehog, or whatever you want to call me, really. Hi everyone, how you doing? It's been a quick month. I can't believe how quickly July has just come and gone. But I guess that's been most of the year, I guess? Like, I was talking to people at work a week ago, and it feels like it was yesterday that it was January, and here it is, the year's already half over. And it feels like the older you get, the faster everything starts to move, and oh, that's uncomfortable. If you're listening to this and you're still one of those kids out there, enjoy it while you can, I guess. Because it's only going to get shorter and shorter and shorter until, well, let's not talk about that right now. Oh, this is a good start to this podcast, isn't it? I guess that's the intro out of the way, isn't it? So, where's the video? Oh, wait, it's out now. I finally finished it. And I still technically missed my deadline. My deadline was July 22nd. I wanted to get it out before the Sonic 25th anniversary party in the House of Blues, wherever that is. I don't know, it's like in Tennessee or something. I should look it up. I'm going to look it up right now. Where is the House of Blues? The House of Blues is in Massachusetts. Wait, is it? Founded in Massachusetts. Headquarters in Los Angeles. Wow, key people that founded it. John Candy and Dan Aykroyd. Wow. That's pretty cool. It still doesn't say where it is, though. It could either be in LA or it could be in Massachusetts. I don't know. I don't really care. The point is I wanted to get my video out. I wanted to get my video out before the 25th anniversary party on July 22nd. And technically, I did. The video, finished editing it like an hour before the stream started, and it was in the middle of rendering when the stream started. I think at some point, I started the upload process while watching the stream. But then at the end, I had to re-render it, and it ended up coming out on July 23rd. But it didn't end up being that big of a deal because the 25th anniversary party wasn't like the big, huge bomb you know what I mean by bomb, right? I don't mean like a bomb like it was bad, even though technically it ended up being kind of a bomb in that way, but I mean like a bomb as in like this explosion of information. It wasn't that. It was just, it was Johnny Guelli in a fetal position on stage. And that's not especially great. But yeah. What was I saying? Sorry, if I sounded distracted there was like a little spider on my computer case here, and I reached up and I grabbed a bottle cap and I smashed him. Just this like little baby spider. I think we had like a spider nest hatch outside somewhere, because there's been a lot of little like itty bitty spiders coming inside the house lately, and I should probably get out the bug spray and, you know, they call it like a bug barrier. You spray around all the windowsills and door frames and things like that so that anything that tries to come inside instantly dies. But that takes effort. Effort. Who needs effort? What? The new video. The video. It's out. I missed my deadline. But, like I said, that ended up being okay. And I'm actually really proud of the response I've been getting to the, I guess I can't really call it the big video anymore. Like, that's what it is in my mind. That was the code name for it for the longest time. Because I didn't have, like, a name for the video. It was just the Sonic Reboot response video or whatever. That's how I thought of it in my head. And in some ways, I was actually kind of embarrassed to say what it was. Because, I don't know, like I say in the video, so many other people have come up with these videos and articles and things about, you know, oh, how should we fix Sonic? Look at me, I'm so smart. And I'll just straight up go out and say this, but I've wanted to do a video kind of like this or something like this for a really, 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 really long time. Some of the ideas in this video are like 10 years old at least, but it always felt so egotistical, I guess, to just assume that I knew the right way to do everything and that, you know, these people who get paid tens of thousands of dollars to be game producers and game designers, to think that I was smarter than them. I hated that. So that's why the whole notion of this being a response to Good Blood kind of finally let me get these ideas out there, because it was like, you know, now I had an excuse. Now I was responding to him. I wasn't telling Sega or Sonic Team how to do their jobs. I was telling some rando YouTuber who I did not agree with how to do his job. And just yesterday, Good Blood left a response, like a comment on my video, and he actually said I did a good job. And that both made me feel incredibly nervous and feel incredibly good. You know, I was kind of hard on him in my video. There was a point towards the end where I circle back around and I don't tell him specifically, but I say, oh, you know, he's not really a Sonic fan because blah, 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 blah. And some people took offense to that. And thinking about it now from that perspective, you know, I could have taken that part of the video out. And thinking that he saw that, that makes me nervous. I'm not a fan of that. If I could go back and redo it, I would take that part out. But yeah, he seems like an all right guy. I mean, it was just two comments. Well, three comments, because I responded to him and he responded to me, and then he responded again to me. But yeah, seems like an all right guy. Probably not deserving of the vitriol he might be getting. Hopefully he's not getting too much. What else about the new video? What else? It was the weirdest feeling being finally done with that video. I tweeted about this. That night after it was done and it was finally uploaded and everything, I had to go to the store to, I don't know, buy food or whatever. I think I might have bought new clothes. I don't remember. And part of the reason I don't remember is because it was this weird sensation. Like, it feels so weird to describe it. Like, it makes me feel like a crazy person. But just having that weight lifted off my shoulders, I strolled into Walmart. And it was this weird feeling like I had come out of this cave. Like it was the beginning of an Elder Scrolls game where you come out of the starter dungeon and suddenly the whole world is before you and the sun is shining and it's like, I am a new person. I'm reborn. There is no more guilt hanging over my head. I am done. I'm here. I'm free. I can do whatever I want. And it was just this weird feeling where it was like, that was the first time I'd been in a Walmart for, like, years. And that's not true. I'd been there, like, a week beforehand. But I just had this guilt hanging over my head. It's the weirdest thing. And if you think I sound crazy for that, you're probably right. Because it's just, it was the weirdest feeling. But another thing was, testament to this new computer here and the whole new capture setup I have, originally, when I captured all my video, I'd captured it in, like, January, I think, most of the file dates were. It was, like, either January or February 2016. And how I ended up capturing it all is I hooked my Roxio game cap up to my laptop, and then my laptop recorded with OBS, because a lot of people said, you know, Sony Vegas plays nice with OBS files, you'll be fine. So I figured if I recorded directly in OBS, then I could import them into Sony Vegas and everything would be cool. I could just use it like that. So it took me like a whole week or something to record all the footage I needed. That was Xbox 360 games, Wii games, Wii U games, PC games, things like that. It took me a whole week to get all this put together. When I got my new computer built, I was going to say last month. It was like a month and a half ago at this point. I looked at all my old footage that I'd captured on my laptop and then transferred to my desktop. I was looking at it all and I thought, my Elgato is a lot better than this now. I wonder if I could just re-record it all. And what I ended up doing was spending about 6 hours re-recording everything. And that's like the amazing thing, right? Is that originally it took me like almost a week to get everything all recorded. And then with my new setup, I re-recorded the entire thing, all the Xbox 360 games, all the... I didn't re-record the PC games, but I did re-record the Xbox, the Wii U, the Wii, etc., etc., etc. And that only took me like 6 hours, as opposed to a whole week. And that's the power of my new computer. And I couldn't be happier for that, because that is awesome. I had a little bit of a panic because I was using... For years now, I've used Sony Vegas 9 to record all my... Not record, to edit all my stuff. Sorry, I don't know why I can't, like, talk today. I can't form thoughts and sentences and words that sound coherent. So if this is a little bit hard to follow, it's probably a little bit hard to follow in my head, too. But I'm just... I've been using Sony Vegas 9 to edit all my videos. And I mentioned this before, I've mentioned this like several times over the years. Sony Vegas is notorious for not playing well with MP4 files. And OBS records exclusively in MP4. The Elgato software records in like a TS file, which is kind of like a Blu-ray video thing. But it will... The Elgato software has an option to convert to MP4, so technically the Elgato records to MP4 as well, and all these MP4s I had that I'd recorded with OBS and the Elgato software, none of them imported into Sony Vegas 9, and I was having a last-minute panic because it was like 12 hours until the stream was supposed to start. And I couldn't edit any of my footage. I couldn't even get it to import into Sony Vegas at all. A friend came through and may have helped me figure out my Sony Vegas problems. But I'm on a newer version of Sony Vegas, let's say. And it works fine with MP4 files. And that's the long and short of that story. They all imported just fine. It was like 200 and something MP4 files, and I drop them into Sony Vegas 9, and Sony Vegas 9 would freeze. I drop them into Sony Vegas 13, and Sony Vegas 13 was like, yeah, don't worry about it. It's fine. I got this. And the great thing about Sony Vegas 13 is that... I went through this a lot with upgrading to Windows 10, is I'd have to go through and try and get new versions of old software that I was using. I think it was last podcast I talked about the panic I had about going from FL Studio 9 to FL Studio 12. FL Studio 12 is a flaming garbage heap that, you know, they completely redid the interface and nothing works right and it doesn't take certain kinds of plugins and it is just a nightmare. And sometimes you go through that. Sometimes the latest version of a piece of software is not the one you want. You want the old version that you know how to use, that works properly, things like that. Final Cut Pro users went through this like 8 years ago, because Final Cut Pro used to be this, you know, industry standard video editing software. And then Apple decided that, you know, Final Cut needed to be more like iMovie. And iMovie is Apple's Windows Movie Maker equivalent. It's the free software that comes with macOS, I think. I don't know. I haven't used macOS in like 15 years, so don't quote me on any of this. But what they basically did is they took Final Cut Pro and they chopped out all these features and they dumbed it down, and the new version of Final Cut... Nobody liked it. I remember Vinny from Giant Bomb complaining about, you know, what did they do to the new Final Cut? None of my projects load. All the plugins are gone. What happened? And I think Apple might have, like, eventually doubled back around and fixed it or something. But yeah, not always, the new version, the newest version of a piece of software is not always the one you want. And there was this brief worry that going from Sony Vegas 9 to Sony Vegas 13 would be a nightmare. And Sony Vegas 13 is almost identical to Sony Vegas 9. They added some new interface features, they tweaked just like a couple little things, just a little bit, but it still looks and acts identical to Sony Vegas 9. In fact, I'm not even sure why it's called Sony Vegas 13. You'd think that going from 9 to 10 to 11 to 12, they must not have done hardly anything to this software. I don't really, outside of improved MP4 support, that's like the only thing I can see that's like legitimately better. But you know what? I'm not going to complain about that, because it is better. It works with the files I'm using, and that is the most important thing. So I'm not going to look a gift horse in the mouth. Sony Vegas 13 can change as little as it wants. If Sony Vegas 14 comes out and it is identical to 13, big thumbs up from me. Don't break what doesn't need to be fixed. Don't fix what doesn't... It's one of those days, man. I blame it on the fact that I've finally been sleeping. Like that crazy Walmart story I told, like just before talking about Sony Vegas 13. Another part of that is that I had like 4 hours of sleep that night, because what happened was, I'd been up like almost 24 hours by the time the 25th anniversary Sonic stream started. And it was getting to be like 10 o'clock here, and I was getting real tired. So I set my big video to upload to YouTube. And I figured, okay, it's uploading to YouTube. It'll be private. I'll check it when I wake up to see if there's like any copyright claims or whatever on it. Because sometimes that happens. So I went to bed. And I slept about 4 hours, and then I woke up, boom, it was like 1 in the morning, it was like 2 in the morning, something like that. I thought, okay, the video must be uploaded by now, I should go check it. And I ended up re-rendering the whole video and everything else. So by the time I went to Walmart later that night, I was probably on the verge of hallucinating because of this video. Because I'd been awake so much. Because the funny thing, another thing I like about going back to this whole, you know, Sony Vegas 13 and editing the video and everything else, I think something that really helped me was putting together what I called the shot list. I think I talked about this on a podcast before, where essentially you picture the video in your mind and you write down visually everything that's happening moment to moment to moment, so that when you finally get to the point of actually putting the video together physically, you know where everything goes. It's just a matter of following your shot list and sticking to that. And truth be told, this half an hour Sonic reboot video, I probably edited the whole thing together in about 12 to 16 hours. Yeah, it was probably closer to 16. What was it? It was all day one day and then like half a day the next day. So it was probably closer to... Well, if you figure, if I work on it from the moment I wake up to the moment I go to bed, that's 18 hours one day. And then if I, half a day the next day, that's like 9 hours. So, what is it? 18 and 9 is 27 hours? So I worked on this video for 27 hours. Which, given that it's a half an hour long, is actually really quick. Like, I complained at the time that it was taking me so long, but, like, normally... I think the Sonic Boom review, which is 22 minutes long, I think that took me, like, on and off, like, 4 or 5 days to edit through. So the fact that I could get a 30-minute video done in, like, half that time is actually really impressive. And again, that's probably the new computer, that's probably the shot list. It helps to be prepared, is basically what I'm saying. Because it was smooth sailing for the most part. It was just a matter of, you know... dragging and dropping everything onto the timeline, doing the paper folding transition, making sure there was a drop shadow, aligning the text properly, making sure it all scrolled onto the screen with the proper pencil sketch transition, which I lost my old pencil sketch transition that I had on my old computer. I don't know. It's probably buried in my files somewhere, but I just need to go find it. So instead I made a new one that I think actually looks better than the old one. But yeah, the new video, I should say it properly. The video was titled, How Do We Fix Sonic? Because the do is capitalized, you see. It's out now, so if you haven't seen it, go watch it. It's pretty cool. Really putting it into my mind that I want to start goofing around with Unity soon here. See what I can accomplish. AJ Frieda, if you know who that is from the old SRB2 project, I think he stopped working on SRB2 a few years ago. He moved on with his life. But after he watched that video, he contacted me about, look what I did. Here's this SRB3, Sonic Roboblast 3, April Fool's joke I did this year. And it was this mod of his Roly Poly Putt game, which is this like golf game he made about this pill bug. It's actually really cute. I kind of like it. I think you can get it on the Android App Store. It might be on iOS. He has a download on his website for it. It's completely free, so check out Roly Poly Putt. But he did this mod for Roly Poly Putt where he put like Sonic assets in it, and you go through the old Sonic Roboblast 2 green flower zone, but now there's all like these ramps and half pipes and things, like it's a skateboarding game, and it's actually kind of cool. And he was talking to me about that, about methods for controlling Sonic in 3D, because he found my ideas interesting, but you know, there are obviously problems with what I suggested in my video, so we've been going back and forth talking about that, and you know, how to do level design in 3D and things like that. I don't know if it'll result in anything cool. Obviously, he has 3D Sonic on the mind. If he's still poking at this Sonic Roboblast 3 April Fool's joke that he did 4 months ago. There's a lot of other things I could do. Whoa, my monitor just went off. Ah, come back on, please. I need my podcast notes. Okay, there we go. There's a lot of different things I could do now that I'm done with my video. I could, for example, as I just said, dive into Unity, for one thing. See what I could scare up in that regard. But I'm so spoiled for choice with everything else. I could get back to work on all kinds of indie games, for that matter. There's the Halloween indie game I started almost a year ago that could probably stand to be finished at some point, because I still think like adventure games are probably kind of easy, and I coded out like this whole inventory system and everything. I think it just needs like a few little extra touch-ups, and then I can start doing backgrounds and dialogue and whatever else. A couple days ago, I was also thinking about those little arcade games I made for Diablo Head. I wrote out like a to-do list for everything left to do on Draconian, which is the game with the knight and the dragon. There's like just like a handful of like little tweaks to make the game feel better, make it a little deeper. And the plan was to finish my Halloween adventure game and then stuff Draconian in there as like a free unlockable or something, and maybe like the other two arcade games I made, Orbit Revolved and Space King, figure out some way to put them in there too. I could buckle down on the book that I've been writing. Just this past month I finally passed the 40 page mark, which is, that's a lot of pages. Like the chapters on this thing are starting to stack up. If I like buckled down and focused exclusively on the book, then I could probably actually maybe have it out by November like I wanted, because it's technically a book about Sonic 06. It's about, you know, the whole lead up to the release of that, and that game's inspirations and its failings, and it's also sort of turning into a weird like autobiography about my life as a Sonic fan. I don't want to give away too much, but the most recent chapter was kind of like a very personal chapter for me. Everyone has problems when they're in like they're in middle school and high school, and I was no different. I don't want to pretend that I had things like super worse than everyone else, but you know, I had a really bad time in school. And there was a reason for me. It's hard to like say these things out loud, I guess. But it's just this really kind of personal chapter about why I became the way I am, I guess. But getting away from that, I've also been thinking about doing like a part two or a response to my Sonic Reboot video. There's been like a lot of misunderstanding about the ideas I put forth in that video. So I'd like to clear up some confusion, maybe expound on some ideas a little bit more. A lot of people have been asking me, you know, well, what about level design? And to be quite honest, I hadn't really thought that much about level design. All these years, I've been mostly thinking about it on a mechanical level, not actual, how does this thing look in 3D, like, actually look? What does the aesthetic of this game look like? What do the levels play like? I haven't thought about any of that stuff quite yet. I mean, a little bit here and there. I've had ideas on what I like and don't like. But, you know, it was a kind of like a game design thing. It wasn't a level design sort of thing. You know, maybe I'll talk about that a little bit. Clear up the misunderstandings. Something that's like really weird about the video to me is that I tried really hard to head some people off at the pass. There are two or three sections in the video where I explain, you know, the ideas I'm about to put forth in this video are things that other Sonic games have done. And I figured that in saying that, I would quell the tidal wave of like dozens and dozens and dozens of people telling me, oh, you know, this system was in that game. This system was in this other game. But I still end up getting at least two comments a day from someone being like, you know, this system was in Sonic Adventure 2, right? The scoring system you like? You know that Sonic Advance did this vertical pole thingy, right? You know that Sonic Colors had this thing. You know that what the control scheme you're describing sounds like Sonic Lost World. No. No, 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 no. Stop it, please. I get it. And some of you are wrong, and some of you are right, and I had hoped that in saying that, yes, I know there are systems like this in existing Sonic games, that people wouldn't leave me so many YouTube comments pointing out exactly where all my inspirations were from. And maybe the lesson here is that I should have just pointed the inspirations out myself. Because that's the only way to really head people off at the pass, is if you say the things for them. And maybe that's me being rude. I'm willing to accept that's me being rude, because, you know, I'm not the biggest conversationalist in the world. There's a reason why nobody else has been on this podcast with me, and it's because I am terrified to talk to another person sometime. I mean, it really depends, and, you know, I'm trying to get comfortable with talking into a microphone and whatever else, and I've been thinking these last couple of podcasts, you know, oh, let's try and get someone on, but then it always comes time to record, and I think, no, it's just easier if I do this by myself, and technically it is, but it would also be nice to bounce ideas off someone else, but, you know, whatever. What I'm trying to say is, I don't know what I'm trying to say. I don't know what I'm trying to say. I'm just saying I want to do a sequel video and just explain a couple things better and respond to people being incorrect about certain things. It probably won't be a half an hour long, but it will be of some length, because there were things I had to cut out of the video originally. There was a whole paragraph near the end that, well, it wasn't even really like a paragraph. It was like three sentences. It felt kind of superfluous in a way. It was something that I inserted kind of at the last minute. It wasn't in the shot list. And I decided, okay, well, this, it doesn't really need to be in there. So even though I said the dialogue, I voiced it myself, I chopped it out and I said, forget it, whatever. It was kind of like just this big summation of everything that I was saying, ending with me saying that what I really just want is the Devil May Cry of racing games. And then I got like a YouTube comment, like a day after I published my video, that said, oh, it sounds like what you really want is the Devil May Cry of racing games. And I thought, yes, you, sir, you get it. You know, you're on my wavelength. All these other people who are saying that it's like Sonic Lost World, they can go jump in a pit. But you, sir, I don't even remember what his name is now. I should have probably looked up his name. He got it. He understood my wavelength. Other things, I have more video ideas too. Right before I started like dipping into Sony Vegas to do the hard work on this Sonic reboot video, I got the idea in my head to do like a Knights video. Long time ago, like back during the game trailers era, when I was posting videos on game trailers, so like 2007, I had this idea for this Knights video, this kind of retrospective. If you know the YouTube channel Ahoy, or like Retro Ahoy, he does like these half an hour retrospectives of mostly shooters. He does, like, if you haven't seen him, he did this really good episode on Doom and Quake and Wolfenstein. They're actually really, really good. They're really in depth. They talk about, you know, how these games were made, how they, what the ideas were, like, that's all the same thing, but you know what I mean, right? It's this kind of almost like documentary presentation about these games. And back in 2007, I guess that's kind of what I wanted to do with Knights, and I never got around to it. Instead, it ended up as kind of like this blog post. And now that Game Trailers is shut down, that blog post is lost to the sands of time forever. You could probably find it on the Internet Archive if you knew where to look. I don't know where to look, and I don't care, because I can just rewrite it, and I kind of want to do that again. At the time, the original reason why I didn't do that video, in 2007, I didn't have a video capture device. I couldn't run the emulators required to play Knights on my PC to record it, so it ended up this blog post. And now that I have all this video production equipment, I'm so much better at narrating videos. I kind of, you know, I think it's the 15th anniversary of Knights this year, and I could go back and I could do this really nice retrospective of things. But that'd be another like half an hour video probably. And that means it probably wouldn't be done until like March. And that would be past the 15th anniversary. So I don't know about that. A few months ago, my Tumblr users, somebody said, you should do a video review for Sonic Unleashed on the Wii. And I thought, do people really want that? So I asked the question to the people on my Tumblr. And I said, do you really want me to do a Sonic Unleashed video review? And I got like 5 people responding to me saying, yes, we want a Sonic Unleashed Wii video review. You should do it. And normally when I ask questions like that to my Tumblr audience, I get like 2 responses. So to get like 5 or 6 is kind of impressive. It means that, you know, maybe I should do a Sonic Unleashed Wii video review, and it would also be kind of a chance to go back to the original Sonic Unleashed video review, the very first one I did when I first got my my EasyCap USB capture device, because you go back and you watch the very first 2 or 3 video reviews I did, and wow, it sounds like a different person. I am so quiet and shy, and I speak so slowly. Well, not, it's like this weird thing. I mean, I probably still do it, but it's this thing where I sound really sleepy like this. And then all of a sudden I'll talk really, really fast and you can't understand what I'm saying. And you can tell I am so nervous. That first Sonic Unleashed video review I did back in like 2009, I put that whole thing together in like 2 days. I just suddenly got it into my head one day. I said, hey, I should do a Sonic Unleashed video review. So I spent 1 whole day capturing everything, and I spent, you know, a couple hours banging out a script, and then like the rest of that next day putting it all together. And that was probably the first time I really seriously used Sony Vegas, too. So if I did, like, a Sonic Unleashed Wii video review, I could go back and, you know, just sort of update my thoughts and update my production value and everything else. I also need to get on the ball and do, like, a Patreon promo video. I need to do a YouTube channel promo video for unsubscribed users, things like that. Because I shouldn't really, like, complain about this, but with my Sonic Reboot video, in about a week and a half, it's gotten 21,000 views, which is very impressive. It is on track to be one of my top 10 YouTube videos across my entire channel. It's gotten me almost 400 new subscribers, which is really impressive because now I'm that much closer to the 10,000 subscriber milestone. But all this attention on this video, and I didn't get a single new Patreon supporter, and that's, like, a little weird to me. I'm not getting a lot of Patreon turnover, and you'd think that, you know, I'd get at least one person, one new person, and I didn't. And that's weird to me. And they say, Patreon says, you're gonna get a lot more support, a lot more easily, if you yourself are on camera and have a promo video to, you know, welcome people when they get to your Patreon page. So I think I need to record one of those. I started on a little bit of a script a couple days ago, but then I got sidetracked by writing the book because I had to go to work. And normally when I write the book, I just write it on lunch breaks. But, you know, I need a Patreon promo video. Somebody needs to tell my lips to get in line so I can speak properly. So I need to do a Patreon promo video. I need to do a YouTube promo video because YouTube has this thing. Let's see if I can find it real quick. I think it's under branding. No, featured content? Yeah, channel ad. Do you have a channel ad? Choose the video and it could be selected as one of the few promoted to your viewers. So it's kind of like this outreach program where sometimes my channel ad will appear before someone else's video. And that's important. So I need to get that done. I used to have one, but it was like really embarrassing. Like I only used it for a few months because I couldn't stand it. It was bad. So I need to come up with something better and snappier and nicer and whatever else. And then what else could I do now that I'm done with this? My big Sonic Reboot video? Well, I could go back to school. It's been a year since I graduated, and, you know, people are starting to ride my case, saying, yo, you should continue with college. My mom wants me to go into, like, a computer graphics animation course, because after talking it over with my teacher when I graduated last year, I told her I wanted to, like, learn Unity and learn Unreal Engine and things like that so that I could more easily get into making 3D games. And she said she turned me on to this computer graphics course at a community college another town over. And she, you know, you should apply for that. You could probably get a grant. You're low income, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now that it's been a year since I graduated, people are starting to say, you know, hey, when are you going to take this computer graphics course? It's been a while. You should probably get on that. And yeah, I probably should. They're not wrong. But I don't know. That makes me nervous. Even though, like, going back to school and graduating last year, that wasn't so bad. It was a big, like, self-esteem boost, right? That's the good part. But, I don't know. It's a long way away. And, like, because it's a low-income community college sort of thing, I wouldn't be, like, on campus. I would have to commute from home, which means an hour bus ride over to the school and then an hour bus ride back. And I don't know, I don't like public transportation. That also makes me nervous because I'm a weird hermit recluse man who doesn't do well in public situations. But coming up on the channel, like, sooner rather than later, I'm probably going to do another Let's Narcissism video, this time for that Sonic Forever fan game. I kind of have the Sonic Mania fever currently. Sonic Mania, I guess you could call it. So I kind of want to, you know, just a little quick thing, because I don't think I'm ever going to finish that fan game. I'd like to, but, I mean, let's be realistic here. The entire reason I never, like, made a big splash about that fan game is because I knew I probably wouldn't finish it. And the fact that I got three whole levels done is probably more impressive than not doing anything at all. So I'll do a video on that, and we'll see what happens. Also, I want to do the Less Narcissism video on that because, well, for a couple reasons. One, if you didn't know, a couple months ago, it finally came out. The version of the Sonic Worlds engine that I have contributed to came out. And I want, like, the things I contributed to the Sonic Worlds engine are things that were in Sonic Forever. And lately, I've been getting this really persistent guy on Twitter, because my DMs are open currently. I forget why I opened them. It was for someone to contact me, but I've just left them open. And it hasn't really been that big of a deal, but lately there's been a couple of people who have slid on into my DMs asking me if they can have the Sonic Forever engine, and I'm not going to give that to them, namely because it's like, it's a super, like, big mess. Like, I'm not an organized coder at all, especially if I'm working alone, then it's just like, oh, you know, it's all in my head, I know how this works. And I don't need to comment anything. I don't need to be organized. I can just do whatever. And that's sloppy, but it works. When I went to the Sonic Worlds engine and contributed my code there, I actually tried really, 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 really hard to be as organized as possible so that if anyone had to reverse engineer the changes I made, they'd know exactly what the engine is doing at any given time. So if I have this person bugging me for the Sonic Forever engine, what I'm going to do in the Let's Narcissism video is I'm going to feature the latest release of Sonic Worlds in my video, and then I'm going to tell them, I'm going to say, hey, if you want the Sonic Worlds engine, or if you want the Sonic Forever engine, just download Sonic Worlds. It's basically the same thing. In fact, it's better than the Sonic Forever engine. It's more organized, there's more features, you know, things like that. And that's absolutely true, because all the Sonic Forever engine really was is, at the time, it was this kind of half-finished, half-broken version of Sonic Worlds that didn't really have certain features applied to it. I had to go in and, like, add all this custom code myself to finish out Knuckles and how shields worked, you know, how Tails flies and things like that. And since then, other people have picked up the Sonic Worlds engine and have gone through and also finished up all of that stuff. So there's no real reason for anyone to want or need or use the Sonic Forever engine at this point. So yeah, look for that Let's Narcissism video coming soon, and, you know, maybe there'll be more development insights into that. I know I just said a lot of things here, but there are things to keep in mind when that video comes. I also need to do closed captions for my Sonic Reboot video. That's usually something I'm on, like, the day that the video uploads. I go in and I transcribe all my sayings, all my words, into a script using Subtitle Workshop. But like I said, I was, like, such a bizarre zombie that day that I figured, I'll do it tomorrow. And then I'll do it the day after that. And then I'll do it, and then I forgot about it for, like, a week. And then it was, we were driving through Boulder yesterday, and it popped into my head, and I thought, oh, I never did captions for that video, so I need to get on that. I might do that later tonight after I'm done with this podcast. Wow, we're at 45 minutes already. Usually these podcasts are 45 minutes long, but this is what talking about this big, long video is doing. I also got to get more stuff up on my Patreon. I told you guys I was uploading music, right? And I uploaded those first three zip files, and then I haven't done anything else since then. I do think about that a lot. The entire reason why I haven't done any more of it is what I want to do with the uploads going forward. The first batch was all the old Sepwitch MP3 files, right? And what I want to do, the next zip files will be things that people haven't, like, generally heard before. We'll start getting into the, I don't want to say less mainstream stuff, but we'll get to the stuff that, you know, maybe isn't as well known, that I haven't uploaded onto websites before. And I want to annotate each MP3 file to kind of explain why it exists and why I didn't use it and things like that. And that's going to take time, so I'll get on that when I get on that. Something else I've been thinking of for a couple months was an RSS feed for this podcast. I came really close a couple times to just signing up for, like, Libsyn or whatever it is, assuming it's a service you can sign up for. But I got an email from Patreon yesterday that said, hey, RSS feeds for podcasts are coming, so if you don't want to listen to this on Patreon's website or through their mobile app, pretty soon you'll just be able to subscribe to this like any old podcast anywhere else. So you can get your monthly dose of me not being able to talk correctly into a microphone. other notes I have written down here. Gosh, this is going to be like another half an hour, isn't it? I guess just real quickly, real briefly, we'll talk about the Scott Fulop Archie lawsuit thing and how I feel about that. If you don't know, Scott Fulop is this, I don't know if he was an artist or a writer or what, but he worked for Archie Comics back in like 1996. He created a handful of characters, maybe a dozen of them, which was like Mammoth Mogul, the Destructix, which I don't remember who is in the Destructix. I remember it's like a gorilla, it's like a hawk, a lynx, like a frog with eyebrows, like a bullfrog. I don't know. He also created a horse called Sean Connery or something. It's like Sir Connery, and he has dumb characters, is the point I'm saying. Characters we don't need, characters that haven't been in the comic in like 4 years. But he created all these characters, and now, as per Ken Pender's example, he is suing Archie Comics for ownership of these characters. And if you don't know this whole thing, back like 3 or 4 years ago, Ken Penders, another former writer for Archie, sued Archie for use of characters he created under their banner. And Ken's doing this because he wants to start this graphic novel called The Last Guardian or something like that. No, it's not The Last Guardian. What is it? The Echidna Chronicles? The Guardian Chronicles? I don't honestly remember, and it's not important. But he's trying to create this graphic novel of characters he made under Archie's banner. And the entire reason he can sue them is because some idiot at Archie didn't draw their contracts up properly. Normally in comic books, what happens is that if you create a comic, like, let's say you're a writer and you work at Marvel Comics. Any character you create while you're working at Marvel Comics instantly becomes the owner. Marvel instantly owns that character and that world and whatever. Like, anything else you create for that character, it is now Marvel's. If you stop working for Marvel Comics, you cannot take your characters with you. They will stay as a Marvel Comics property. And sometimes there's loopholes about this. I think there was one comic writer who created this character, and he got special permission when he went over to DC Comics to bring his character with him. And sometimes that does happen, but normally it doesn't. Normally, you create a character under Marvel Comics, it is now a Marvel Comics character. What Archie did wasn't this. Somebody didn't draw up the contracts right up at Archie, or, like, didn't draw up contracts at all. So, technically, guys like Ken Penders, the characters they created for the Archie Comics Sonic series, Archie doesn't actually own them. Nobody owns them. So, what you ended up having was this scenario where Ken Penders went through, and he copyrighted all the characters he made during his tenure at Archie. And he worked at Archie for like 13 years. So as you can imagine, he had a lot of characters. And what he ended up doing is he spun around and he said, okay, Archie, stop using my characters. Stop putting them in Sonic Comic. I'm not going to allow you to do that anymore because they are my property. And I don't like that, but I can understand why Ken Penders would do that. Like, it's not a good reason, it's not a great reason, but it is a reason, because he wants to publish his own graphic novels featuring the characters he created and the storylines he created. He wants to continue all this stuff. And, you know, that's his business. That's fine. It's not fine, but it is understandable in a way, even though To me, it sounds like Ken Penders is just really bitter that he eventually got fired for Archie for being a really bad writer. He made such a mess of that comic book. But that's a different story altogether. And when Ken Penders did this, he actually told Archie. He said, "Hey, I'm in contact with a bunch of other writers and artists, and I'm telling them about this. And they're going to come calling for their characters." And that's where this Scott Fulop guy comes in. He comes in and he says, "Okay, Mammoth Mogul, he's mine. Captain Simeon, he's mine. Sir Connery the Horse, he's mine. Archie, you can't use these characters anymore." And Archie hasn't been using these characters. Mammoth Mogul hasn't been in an Archie Sonic comic since 2012. Because when Ken Penders said, you know, "Hey, I'm telling all these other guys what they can do," Archie got wise and, you know, shut it off and said, "Okay, get rid of all these characters, reboot the comic, they're gone." But what Archie's been doing in the interim is, until these guys have come calling, they've been reprinting back issues. They've been doing it digitally, they've been selling graphic novel collections at comic book stores and things like that. Now Scott Fulop is coming along and he says, "Okay, here's all my characters. You guys are selling more than 700 products featuring my characters, and I want residuals for that." And that's currently the problem, and I don't entirely agree with that. I don't think Scott Fulop is going to do anything with these characters. I don't think he's going to write the Mammoth Mogul comic book series, because Mammoth Mogul was a third-string villain that was honestly kind of lame. He was a riff on, like, a DC Comics villain. What was his name? Vandal Savage, I think it was? This dude from, like, the prehistoric era who found this meteorite that made him immortal. And that's basically Mammoth Mogul. He is a mammoth from prehistory, from dinosaur times, and he found a meteorite that made him immortal. And now he's like this kingpin character. He walks around with this staff, and he's in this suit, and he supposedly has mystical powers. I never liked Mammoth Mogul. He was such a loser. And Ken Penders loved Mammoth Mogul. He wrote this whole big Chosen One storyline where Tails and Mammoth Mogul had this showdown, and it was the worst thing you can ever imagine. So yeah, I guess it kind of makes sense that Scott Fulop would try and claim ownership of his horrible, awful, terrible characters. But he's still suing for more than 700 items. He wants thousands and thousands of dollars from Archie Comics, if not millions of dollars. People out there are singing doom and gloom that this could be the end of the Sonic comics entirely, because at this point, for Archie, it's nothing but a liability, as more and more of these guys are going to come calling for the money they're supposedly owed, and I put that in scare quotes, because I don't think these guys are owed anything. If Ken Penders wants to write a graphic novel that continues the adventures of the Guardians or whatever, why does he need his characters to do that? I mentioned it before about if you work for Marvel Comics and you create a character for Marvel Comics, that Marvel now owns that character. Yes, but that doesn't stop you from going to, like, DC and creating a nearly identical character. This kind of sort of happened with... what is it? It's Deadshot from DC Comics. Is it Deadshot? Dead something? Here. I'm going to look this up real quick. Deadshot. Who is Deadshot? Yes, with Deadshot from DC Comics. He was this, you know, this master assassin. He wore this mask. And then Rob Liefeld joined Marvel Comics. Rob Liefeld didn't create Deadshot, but what he did is he created Deadpool, which is basically just Marvel's version of Deadshot, or it was at the time. This was long before the goofy cartoon character known as Deadpool that we know today. This was the original appearance of Deadpool when he was this hard-edged assassin. He was literally just Deadshot. There is nothing stopping you from creating a legally distinct copycat of an existing character. So if Ken Penders wanted to continue the whole saga of the Guardians, there was nothing stopping him on just creating similar but different characters. I don't think Archie would have cared at all. They were killing off those characters left and right. They were getting rid of them. And this was before Ken Penders started, like, his whole legal tirade against Archie. It's just, it's so ridiculous. And Scott Fulop is not going to do anything with Mammoth Mogul. He just wants money. He just wants to get in there and say, give me the money I think I'm owed, because there's a legal loophole that Archie was too stupid to plug up. That's all he wants. He wants money. And he wants to damage the brand of what I think has grown to be a fairly nice... It's a fun comic book nowadays. It's so much better than it used to be. The Archie Sonic comic is something that I'm actually starting to look forward to reading now, because I've been, like, every now and then I catch up. And I've caught up to the point where I'm at the most recent comic book. I bought the Sonic Mega Drive Limited Edition issue. I have the first run print. I just read the most recent issue of the Archie Sonic comic last night. And it's fun. I like it. I want to keep reading it. But if guys like Scott Fulop are coming along and saying, give us money, here is a loophole we know exists that we're going to exploit to copyright characters we know Archie forgot to claim ownership of. And that's just, that sucks. That these people would be so motivated by greed that they would risk... Well, they're literally biting the hand that fed them. They were already paid for their work back in 1996 when they created all these characters. And now they just want more. They want residuals that, by most other standards in the comic book industry, they shouldn't be entitled to. Maybe in a perfect world, they should be entitled to those characters normally, but they aren't. And the only reason that they are is because of this loophole, this... Because, like, back in the 90s, Archie was apparently run kind of poorly. The fact that they didn't draw up proper freelancer contracts for all these characters should tell you that, like, completely. And maybe there was, like, an instance where Scott Fulop and Ken Penders felt underappreciated for their work. And maybe I get that, but I still don't think that it's right for them to swoop in and say, give me more money than what I was already paid for these characters. And it's just, that sucks. I don't like that. They shouldn't be doing that. Let's wrap up the podcast here real super quick. I haven't been playing much video games. Obviously, I was too busy with the video. So really, most of what I've played in the week and a half since releasing the video is just like little bits and pieces of things. I haven't really... dove headfirst into a really long game just yet. I'm kind of browsing what I want to do. I mean, technically what I want to do is that now that I finally have the time to, I was gifted a copy of Undertale a few months ago, so I could finally play through Undertale, figure out, you know, what all the buzz about that was. And then right around Christmas, I was gifted Firewatch, I think, by a Patreon supporter, in fact. So I also need to want to go through that. So in the interim, I've basically just been playing games casually. I haven't really, like, stuck with any one thing for any length of time. So we're just going to go through a real quick list of little bits of pieces and things of whatever I've played over the last week and a half, which, starting at the top of that list, is Kirby's Air Ride. That was featured during Summer Games Done Quick, and I thought it looked really fun. It looked really fast, it looked really technical. It was by Sakurai, the developer, the game designer behind Super Smash Bros., so, you know, of course it's going to be this really technical game. I can play it on Dolphin now, which means, you know... Kirby's Air Ride is like an 11-year-old game at this point, and Nintendo's never made it available for anyone to ever play ever again, so I don't feel too bad about admitting the fact that I pirated Kirby's Air Ride, because if I got it off of eBay at this point, Nintendo's not going to see that money. Playing Kirby's Air Ride, I learned that, yes, it is, in fact, a very technical game. It is perhaps a little too technical for me, because it is, that is not an easy game to play. It is a unique game. It is a racing game featuring Kirby, and kind of like Sonic Riders, you're always accelerating forward. You have no accelerator button. Instead, you have like this boost button that counts as like also kind of a drift button, and there's like grind rails and, like equipable stat upgrades and all this other like crazy stuff, and I'm not very good at it. I can kind of see why it didn't really stick, because it has this like mountainous learning curve, and it's just, it's not grabbing me the way I thought it might. Not even City Trial. I think the thing to keep in mind about City Trial is that that's primarily like a multiplayer mode, so the fact that I'm just sitting here alone playing it by myself, I'm probably not going to get much out of that. So, you know, I played Kirby's Air Ride for probably like an hour one day, maybe like a couple times over the course of whenever, and it like, I acknowledge that it's probably a really good game, and I saw the SGDQ run, and that looked amazing, but when I play it, I am not that good at that game, and there is little to no incentive to learn how to play it. So, I don't know, it's like 400 megabytes, so it'll probably stick around on my hard drive for a little while. But then there was also, I decided to try and play Star Fox Assault. Star Fox Assault, not Assault. Star Fox Zero had come out, and I was thinking, you know, I'm kind of in a Star Fox mood, and I've played the first hour of Star Fox 64 like 1,000 times at this point, so I wanted like a new Star Fox game, and it was either Star Fox Assault, or there was the Star Fox games I really don't like, which is Star Fox Adventures. That's not like a bad game, but it's not a very good Star Fox game. There's Star Fox Command on the DS, and I hate Star Fox Command. It's not a great game. I don't like the touch controls, but whatever. There's Star Fox 2 on the Super Nintendo. I don't like that either. That's basically Star Fox Command, but a lot shorter. So I downloaded Star Fox Assault on the GameCube, because I remember, like, back in the day when this first came out in, like, 2005, I rented it, and I kind of liked it. It was not, like, the worst game in the world, but it was nice to see, like, Star Fox in this kind of shootery scenario again. So, you know, it's short. I figured, you know, whatever, I'll just play Star Fox Assault. I'll probably beat it in a single sitting, because I think I did back when I rented it. And I didn't beat it, because for as much as I liked that game back in the day, and admitted, you know, it has faults, but I still liked it in spite of these faults, playing it now, those faults are not only a lot more prevalent, but even the stuff I liked about it hasn't aged very well. It's this really limp-feeling game. All the dialogue is really flat. The sound effects don't have any punch. It's just this really weirdly bland game that, I keep telling myself that I'll go back and I'll finish it, because I probably played almost half the game the last time I played it, because like I said, it's not very long. It's about, I'd say, 4 hours long, 5 hours, maybe less than that, maybe like 3 hours. Like, it's the kind of game that if you're really dedicated, you can probably finish in a single sitting. But it's just, I can't really get into the mood for it anymore. Those on-foot sections are just, they're really, like, the levels are too big, the movement's too, like, fast and stiff, and it's just, it's not a great time. And, like, the sound design, I mean, I can't get over the sound design enough. The R-Wings sound like vacuum cleaners, all the explosion effects are just really muted, it's just, Star Fox Assault, man. Star Fox in general. It's just, that's a big bummer of a franchise right there. It goes to Star Fox 1, Star Fox 64, and then you can ignore everything after that, apparently. And between Star Fox Assault and Kirby's Air Ride, especially Kirby's Air Ride, I got in the mood to play Sonic Riders again, and I ended up playing, that's probably actually the only thing I've seriously played in the last month, is I went through all of Sonic Riders again, both stories, all the side missions, just, what was it, last night or the night before, I finally unlocked Knights and Ai and Ulala, the three main secret characters you unlock for completing all the side missions. fans. And I still like Sonic Riders. It still has a lot of problems. Like Kirby's Air Ride, it has this incredibly steep learning curve. But once you get past that learning curve and you understand how to play the game properly, I find it to be very rewarding, and probably the same way that people like Kirby's Air Ride. This is I think I said this before maybe, but this is the third time I've played through Sonic Riders. And, you know, I still like that game. I still like the way the trick system feels, the way that when you go off a trick, okay, let me back up. For one, I like the sense of tension and release when you come up on a trick ramp. You have to hold down the jump button and you slow to a crawl until you release the jump button, and then you get this giant jump, this big, you get launched into the sky, and then it's like time slows down, and that feels really good so that you can rotate the analog stick and do tricks. And that system right there, the tension of charging up before a ramp, the release, the big jump, the way the camera pulls into your character so you can do tricks, the way it feels like time slows down, that is the loop of what about Sonic Riders I think feels really, really, really good. And that's probably what keeps me coming back to the game, is that one loop, that one game feel loop of the charge, the release, the tricks, the slowdown, the camera, and the landing, and you boost off really fast, and I love that feeling. That's the one thing that Sonic Riders gets so, so right, and that's the one thing that all Sonic Riders games following the first Sonic Riders got wrong. The trick system in Sonic Riders Zero Gravity is garbage, and all the stuff that they changed and replaced for Zero Gravity doesn't make up for it. I hate Sonic Riders Zero Gravity. It is not a very good game. And then you have this Kinect game, and I can't imagine that feels very good either. Sonic Free Riders or whatever it's called. But yeah, Sonic Riders, I like it. That's just it. Started a new game in Super Mario Sunshine for some reason. Actually, it's been coming up on my channel a lot, so I ended up starting up a new game on Super Mario Sunshine. I think I'm about 20 shines in. The thing to really note about Super Mario Sunshine this playthrough is that I've actually been cheating a lot. One thing that Dolphin makes that, super easy is that you go into a game, the game's, properties page, the settings page, and there's a tab for action replay codes, and at the bottom of that tab, it just says download cheat codes, and you hit a button, and suddenly you have all the cheat codes for that game, so you can just, it is so easy to cheat in these games using Dolphin. So I've actually been replaying Super Mario Sunshine with cheats turned on. Infinite hover nozzle, and that's the main one. And you can actually break the game pretty hard using the infinite hover nozzle cheat, because that actually counts for all your power-up nozzles too. So in Super Mario Sunshine, you get a rocket nozzle upgrade that, you know, shoots you 150 feet into the air, and then you fall down, and it's how you climb these really high mountains and vertical spaces. If you have the infinite hover nozzle cheat turned on and you use the rocket boost, you never come down. You have to be so careful with that rocket boost, because you'll just be 1,000 miles into the stratosphere. You'll look down and you can't even see the level anymore because it's scrolled out of view. The first time I did it, what I ended up doing is I shot myself into the sky, and then I butt stomped, and Mario was stuck in that butt stomp state for 10 minutes until he finally made it back down to the level. So it is ridiculous and kind of fun. I just wish that there was a way to turn cheats on and off within the game while the game is still running. Because what you end up having to do is, if you want to turn a cheat on or off, you have to quit out of the game and then go into the game settings and uncheck that cheat. And then that turns it off. But you have to exit out of the game first. That's not great. Just the other day, I played an hour of Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet for the PC. That was probably the very first game I got on my Steam account that wouldn't work on Windows XP. So Now that I'm on Windows 10, I can finally play Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet, this game from like 6 years ago, back when Ryan Davis was still alive at Giant Bomb doing the running of the lanterns at Whiskey Media. Whew. Yeah, that was a long time ago. Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet is an alright game. You can tell it feels like a game that's maybe 6 years old. The interface isn't quite as sharp as a modern game. The graphics look maybe a little bit dated, but, you know, it feels like an Xbox Live Arcade game from back before they just started being games, back when they were supposed to be these tiny little compact things that would be in, like, the summer of arcade or whatever, right? It's all right. But I don't know, I'm not really in the mood for a Metroidvania right now. It's interesting enough, and maybe I'll go back to it, but I don't entirely feel like I should go back to it. It's not really grabbing my attention, and especially when I have Undertale and Firewatch to get to, it doesn't really feel like the sort of game that would require me to... It's not like grabbing me and saying, before you play Undertale and Firewatch, you have to play Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet. No, it's not doing that. It's just merely okay. It's the kind of thing that, you know, maybe 6 months from now I'll pick up again, because I'm not very far into the game, so... Right before or right after Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet, I launched Mortal Kombat 9, because, again, that was another one of those games that wouldn't work on Windows XP, but it would work on, now that I'm on Windows 10, it works just fine. And, you know, I was watching YouTube at the time, so I didn't really want to dive into the story mode, but that's kind of like the main thing I want to try about Mortal Kombat 9 is the story mode. But instead, I went through arcade mode, I think like once. I don't think I even got to the end of arcade mode. I loaded it up with, I almost said Wolverine, Scorpion. That guy, the yellow one, Mustard. And yet, something I like about Mortal Kombat 9, and I guess it's probably the same about Mortal Kombat 10, and maybe even Mortal Kombat 3, is how easy it is to do special moves. I'm not the kind of person who can ever do, like, a Hadouken. The motion has always just kind of eluded me, the sort of, the way you have to roll your thumb. It never feels like it comes out properly. And then you have charge characters and all this other nonsense. And Street Fighter, just special moves and executing special moves in that game never really feels terribly consistent. And if you ask fighting game players, I suppose they'll tell you that's something that they really like about Street Fighter, because it has this learning curve and they have this knowledge and this practice and this training to be able to pull these moves out with 99% accuracy and not drop them. Mortal Kombat isn't like that. Mortal Kombat, I guess Jeff Gerstmann of Giant Bomb describes it as a game that's meant to be played with a D-pad, and that's probably entirely true. There are no quarter circle... There goes my lips again. There are no quarter circle motions in Mortal Kombat. If you want to do Scorpion's spear throw, it is back A button. That's it. If you want to do a teleport, it is down back B. Teleport. Done. You don't have to roll your thumb for any of these moves. It is always just like a hard cardinal direction and a button, and that makes it really easy to get these moves to come out. And they're never more than like three button presses away. Like I mentioned, the teleport move, which is down, back, and another button, that's probably about as long as any special move gets. Unlike Street Fighter, where, you know, if you want to do an ultra in Street Fighter 4, you have to do like two quarter circles and you have to hit all three punch buttons at the same time. And that's ridiculous. If you want to do an ultra, or whatever you want to call it, an X-ray move in Mortal Kombat 9, you just hit both triggers together and you do it. And that is fantastic for somebody like me who likes fighting games but isn't especially like great at them. Mortal Kombat 9 feels like a fighting game I could get into, except for the fact that, like, even though I'm singing the praises of this Mortal Kombat game for being so easy to get into, I kind of don't like the rhythm of fighting. It's very, like, stop and start, I guess. Where, you know, the combos feel a little too, there's no, like, flow to the game. It's always just this, it's so hard to describe what I mean, right? Street Fighter flows like water. You know, everything chains into itself, and you have these like impromptu combo strings that, you know, feel improvised. And in Mortal Kombat 9, it's a lot more rigid than that. You know, you punch a guy and he reels back, and it doesn't flow together like water. That's the only way I can describe it, really. I'm not articulate enough to describe what I mean by, like, the stop and start feeling. It feels like you're snapping into pre-canned combo strings or something like that. I don't know. It's weird, and I'm not entirely sure if I'm a fan of it, but, you know, it's a thing. Whatever. We need to move on. Instead of me just sitting here going, Mortal Kombat. I installed Criterion's Need for Speed Hot Pursuit the other day. This was another game I wanted to try out and see how it ran on the new computer, because on the old computer, even though I met all the system requirements on my old computer, Criterion did this awful thing where with AMD Radeon graphics cards, there was like a driver compatibility problem. And when you were running a race, you'd come around like a corner, and I guess it had to like load things that were around that corner. And when it would load these things that were around that corner, the game would stutter and die like instantly. It would go from like 60 frames per second to 10 frames a second. And it would like just chug and chop and stutter along for like 2 or 3 seconds until everything got all loaded down that turn. And then it would jump back up to 60 frames per second again. So with my new computer, I wanted to see how that still like handled, because I still have an AMD Radeon card in this system. And as it turns out, the stuttering problem is still there. But everything in my system is so fast that it kind of doesn't matter. When you come around a turn and it has to load everything, you'll notice the stuttering for like a quarter of a second. And it's the kind of thing that happens so quickly that if you didn't know to look for it, you wouldn't even know it was there. But since I knew the places where that game stuttered, I knew what to look for and I noticed it. But again, it's everything about this system is so fast, there's so much RAM, that the stuttering is just, it's over in a second. It's over in less than a second. Like, it's over so quickly that the frame rate counter in Steam doesn't even register that anything happened. But you can still, like, you get just like this brief second where it goes chop chop and then it's done. Like, for just 2 frames, it's done. And that's all right. I like that. That's pretty cool. And then I discovered that, you know, even with the choppy frame rate problems, I had played so much Need for Speed Hot Pursuit that I was actually like 2 races away from the end of the game. So last night I re-beat Need for Speed Hot Pursuit again. I finished it on the Xbox 360 like 3 years ago, and I just finished the PC version last night. So now, you know, I can dive into like all the cop missions, but playing as the cop in Need for Speed Hot Pursuit isn't like the greatest thing in the world. So, you know, I've been toying with the idea of resetting my save file and just starting Hot Pursuit over from the beginning again, because that's a really good racing game. And then like a few months ago, EA gave away Need for Speed Most Wanted for free, and I guess I could dive into that too. But that doesn't sound like a very good game. Like, reviews were kind of lukewarm on Most Wanted, so we'll see. My cousin bought me Tabletop Simulator. We spent like a half an hour goofing around with that. That's a pretty interesting thing. I don't want to call it a game because it's more like a client. It is a tabletop simulator. You get like a table and then you can put game pieces on that table. And really all that Tabletop Simulator is it's just like a multiplayer physics simulator. So, you know, all the game pieces are physics objects, all the cards are physics objects, and you have a chat room where you can talk to your friends and keep track of whose turn it is and everything. And that's a really smart idea, but what had ended up happening is that we were just goofing around with physics objects for a half an hour, like spawning in marbles and then using the flick command to knock down all the game pieces. It was one time. We started out trying to seriously play a game of Flux Rick and Morty Edition. And There's a dice, I guess, that goes with that game. Oh, no, it was a quarter, because you flip a coin for some of the card effects. And they go, oh, a flick command, what is this? So I grab the quarter, and I pull back on it, and I flick it. And I flick it so hard it blasts all the cards off the table. It was just this moment of complete surprise where I just totally screwed up this whole game and mixed all the cards up and made a mess of everything, and I didn't mean to. And I haven't laughed that hard in probably multiple years. Just the shock of, oh no! As cards go flying everywhere, as game pieces go flying everywhere. That was a good time. I want to play more Tabletop Simulator, but it seems kind of hard to get into because it's kind of like, you know, sitting down with friends and trying a new board game. You know, you have to sit down with this mile-long list of instructions you have to read. And like, we were looking up guides for how to play Rick and Morty Flux, and all the guides for Flux just say, just read the cards. You'll pick it up as you go. And I'm like, what? What is a keeper? What is a creeper? What does a goal card do? It's like, just figure it out. You'll get it. No, I won't. But we ended up finding a guide. But then, you know how board games can go. Someone walks away from the table for a little while. And it's like, whose turn is it now? I don't know. What if I just load up YouTube videos on this fake iPad that you can spawn on your game board? I sat there watching my own YouTube videos while he was off doing something else. Finally, I tried Spooky's House of Jump Scares, which has actually been renamed to Spooky's Jump Scare Mansion after some European company tried to bookmark House of Jump Scares, which is a ridiculous concept in itself. You'd think that Spooky's House of Jump Scares would count as prior art, but I'm no copyright lawyer, so I don't know. But just real quick, one thing I didn't expect about Spooky's House of Jump Scares, or Spooky's Jump Scare Mansion, or whatever you want to call it, I didn't expect it to have, like, legitimate atmosphere to it. I've watched, like, two Let's Players play through Jump Scare Mansion, Markiplier and Two Best Friends Play. So, you know, I kind of had an idea of what that game was about. It's got these very simple visuals. This very, like, cutesy, almost like Adventure Time art style. The main, I guess, villain is Spooky. She's this ghost. And she kind of looks like Marceline from Adventure Time. And with all this spooky art style, you don't expect it to be scary. But it is weirdly effective in that regard. Because it catches you off guard. What it does, it's kind of like the PT thing, right? Where it's this repetition, and through repetition, you let your guard down, and then it pops out a monster, and it says, boo! You go, holy crap! That was scary. And then it gets into, like, the Slender Man thing, where you're doing things in a world, and now you have a monster chasing you, and you have to get away from the monster as quickly as possible, because you do have a health meter, and if the monster catches you, you're going to take damage, and you're going to eventually die. And you have, like, a stamina meter, so you can only run so much. And all of these really simple elements, all these really cutesy art style things, all come together to make a game that actually feels like kind of actually scary in a way I honestly didn't expect. And another thing about it is that it's made in Game Maker. And if you know anything about Game Maker, it's not really like a 3D powerhouse in the way that, like, say, Unity is or Unreal Engine. And I actually thought Spooky's House of Jump Scares or Spooky's Jump Scare Mansion was made in Unity. But no, it's made in Game Maker. And that kind of contributes to it because you end up with this, like, this weird sort of collision detection that doesn't really work right. And you end up, like, actually getting hung up on corners a lot when you're running away from a monster. And that actually, as annoying as that sounds, as much as it, like, it sounds like the game is broken, it actually contributes to the tension a lot, because you're trying to get away from this monster, and you get hung up on a corner, and it's like, oh no, he's right behind me, just gotta move a little bit to the left, and now I gotta get around this corner. And that's actually kind of cool from, like, a horror game standpoint, that I actually really like, in a weird way. Now it's got me thinking again about that YouTube series about horror games and whether or not they scare me. And I'm thinking about things. October's coming up. September is next month. And if I'm going to start recording something like that, it's going to have to be soon. So again, that's another thing that I could really get going on here in the future now that I'm done with the big How Do We Fix Sonic reboot video. But yeah, that's a podcast, and that's a long podcast. That's almost an hour and a half of podcast. But I'm going to also try, usually what I do in Audacity is there's this option called truncate silence, and if I take long pauses between words, it'll try and shorten them down a little bit. It usually does a pretty good job, so hopefully this podcast, once I run that through it, it'll be like an hour and 10 minutes, hour and 20 minutes, something like that. But yeah, that's the end of the podcast. Thank you all Patreon supporters for supporting me. I'll get some music up for you guys to listen to soon. We got bloopers from the Sonic reboot video that'll also be going up soon. There's not very many. There's maybe like three or four. But those will be going up eventually at some point. Hopefully within like the next week, we'll say. And then we got the music, and then, at some point I should start, posting all the artwork for the video. I scan them all like at 600 DPI, so they're really high resolution. And then, maybe at some point this month I can like buy a scanner or something. I don't know. I have to check like scanner prices. I can get a cheapy scanner for like $50, but if I want something that won't be like blurry and terrible, we are looking at like $90 to $100. But if this YouTube video keeps doing as well as it does, either by September or October, I should start seeing the money from that. And that's going to be more money than I've made from a YouTube video in a really long time. So that's also really good. I should probably keep this momentum going. But anyway, whatever, podcast is done. I'll see you guys next month. It'll be September. So I'll see you then. Goodbye.